An infraorbital nerve block will anesthetize the skin of the face from the lower eyelid down to the upper lip. It's a great block for any painful procedure of this region, which is commonly a laceration repair. Before an intraoral injection, I recommend applying topical lidocaine to the site, which can be done with viscous lidocaine on a 2x2 gauze or with a commercially available lidocaine product, leaving it in place for a couple of minutes. Using a 25 to 27 gauge 1.5 inch needle, insert it through the mucosa of the second premolar, that's the fifth tooth over, and aim up to the foramen, which is about 2 centimeters from the mucosa. Aspirate and inject 2 to 3 mL of local anesthetic. If you're very careful to not poke yourself, you can place a finger over the foramen to feel the anesthetic infiltrate and prevent it from going into the lower eyelid with some gentle pressure.
This is an example of the Dix-Hallpike Maneuver. To begin, we place our hands on the patient's head and rotate their head 45 degrees to one side. Then we rapidly have the patient lay down and extend their head off the edge of their bed so that their head is hanging approximately 30 to 60 degrees in extension. We're going to hold the patient's head in this position and observe their eyes for the presence of nystagmus. This will generally be a rotary and vertical nystagmus, if positive. We can then return the patient to the upright and seated position and repeat the procedure on the contralateral side.
That mandibular condyle has slid forward in front of the articular eminence, and it's stuck in that position. First, wrap up your thumbs in some gauze or tape so you don't get bit or cut during the reduction. With the patient relaxed or sedated, you're going to insert your thumbs into the patient's mouth, press down on the molars, and slide back posteriorly. She's using quite a bit of force. She's up on the bed, pressing hard, but constant steady pressure will also fatigue the muscles. And watch it slide in right about here. Now you can see why wrapping your thumbs is so important. In this case, there wasn't a big satisfying clunk, but Dr. Falsgraf, who performed the procedure, said that it slid in nice and smooth. While the patient was waking up, we put him in this modified Barton bandage to give him a little jaw support, really prevent him from yawning and dislocating again. And he definitely needs to follow up with OMFS. This patient has an auricular hematoma. Do a sterile prep of the entire ear, plain lidocaine, inject inferior to the ear. On the anterior side, you're aiming up towards the tragus, and on the posterior side, you're just aiming to the posterior aspect of the ear. Same thing above the ear, and save some local anesthetic for where you're going to make your incisions. For the first incision, we're gonna follow the fold of the helix. Make a superficial incision so you don't cut deep into the cartilage. Gently deloculate, use some pressure to squeeze out all that blood. Flatten that ear back down to its normal shape. This is just a standard closure with a 6-0 nylon using simple interrupted sutures. The final step is the ear bolster. Take a dental roll wrapped in zeroform gauze, and put that into the curvature of the ear, and then some padding with fluff or 4x4s behind and on top of the ear. It's going to need to stay in place for about 7 days. And then the patient can return to have it removed and rechecked. The Stimson maneuver is an option for patients with anterior shoulder dislocations who are able to lay prone. Use a soft restraint on the patient's wrist and hang a 2.5 kilogram or roughly 5 pound weight from the arm. This provides constant traction on the arm, hanging in 90 degrees of flexion at the shoulder. Once the patient tolerates 2.5 kilograms, you can increase this to 5 kilograms or roughly 10 pounds. This may take considerable time, but can be augmented by additional maneuvers. Apply scapular manipulation by palpating the inferior tip of the scapula and gently rotate it medially toward the spine. This alone may relocate the shoulder, or you may have to hold it in this position. If reduction is not yet achieved, add external rotation of the arm, which in this case successfully relocated the shoulder.